Hello everyone, what is up? It is me, AlbyMTG. For today's video, I'm going to be introducing you guys to the Content Creators Community Cup, which is this event that I'm participating in. It has about 40, I think it's 40, of some other content creators from Magic the Gathering, and we're just going to play some games, kind of relax, collaborate together. Should be a quite the fun time. We're given these monthly challenges, split up into teams, and we get to work together with all these other content creators. So it's a great little experience here, and I wanted to, of course, share the experience with you guys here on the channel. So what we have here is the deck that I'll be playing in month one of the competition. We'll be playing a total of 12 games with this deck here, and I'll explain things a little bit more about the tournament itself here as we talk about the deck building restrictions. But we're split up into teams of four, and we're going to play each member of the other team in three best of one games, no sideboards, and together your team, you know, accumulates these points as you win matches against your opponents. And each month we end up with different teams, so we'll be switching it up, and I'll be working with some other content creators, and eventually there will be prizes at the end. We're not really overly concerned with the prizes right now. We just want to have fun, work with some other content creators, and it should be a lot of fun. So here in month one, the content creators that are on my team for this month are Bronson MTG, Langalia, MTG Color Pie, and then myself. We are the team of four. I wasn't super familiar with the remainder of my team. I think I follow MTG Color Pie on Twitter or something like that beforehand, but the rest of my team I didn't really know, so getting a chance to work with them was pretty cool. And we each ended up building a little bit of a different deck. I'm going to go over the deck that I'm playing in this month's matches for this one. So the deck building restriction that we had for this month's competition was we were given a random wedge slash shard. The wedges and shards are things like Mardu, Sultai, Esper, Jund, as you guys can see here, was my given shard, I believe. Shard. Jund's a shard. So this was what I was given. We were given Jund, and then another deck building restriction that we were put with was that we couldn't have any rare or uncommon lands in our deck. We could only use basic lands and lands that were printed at common. So you have access to things like the Guild Gates, things like Cinder Barrens and Foul Orchard from like M19 and the starter decks, those sort of things. And you have access to like Gateway Plaza and Evolving Wilds, but you're missing out on the Shock Lands, you're missing out on the Check Lands, you're even missing out on things like Field of Ruin from Ixalan, because that was an uncommon, the Memorial Cycle from Dominaria, things like Memorial to Genius and Memorial to Folly, which are all playable cards. You couldn't put those in your deck, so you were stuck with a pretty iffy sort of mana base. But I think the deck that I ended up putting together is a pretty nice one. So the deck that I ended up putting together here, I titled it Jund Rhythm, because it's really revolving around the card Rhythm of the Wild. This card is just fantastic. 3 mana for an enchantment. Creature spells you control can't be countered. Non-token creatures you control have first strike. So we were given the team that we were going to be playing against, and so we all knew what shards or wedges we were going to be playing against. We ended up playing against Jeskai here in round one, so I wanted to make a deck that was probably going to be pretty good against what Jeskai could throw together. I felt like there was going to be some sort of a control deck that the Jeskai opponents were going to end up playing, and so I was a little bit worried about maybe some counter spells if I was going to play a creature deck. So I ended up choosing to play 4 copies of Rhythm of the Wild, and then you can see we also have some other good cards that are just quite strong against control in terms of big creatures, like Nullhide Ferox is a pretty tough one for control to handle, and Carnage Tyrant, again, another pretty hard one for control to handle, but at the same time, they're just giant creatures, so they work really well with Rhythm of the Wild as well. If we need to close out a game really fast, we can go ahead and give them haste. If for some reason we need to make them even bigger than they already are, then we can go ahead and give them a +1/+1 counter as well. So to go along with them, we do have some mana dorks. We're running 4 Llanowar Elves, 4 Incubation Druid, just so we can really get out these big, powerful creatures later on in the game. We want to get out our Ferox, we want to get out our Tyrants, and we want to get out something like a Scargan Hellkite as well. That way, if the board's a little bit clogged up and maybe we don't want to attack with Carnage Tyrant because they can just like trade off with it or something, we can still get in some damage in the air via the Scargan Hellkite, which I think is pretty solid. So we want to ramp out into getting one of these, you know, giant creatures down, maybe even multiple of these giant creatures down. That would be pretty nice. And so then we have the Mana Dwarfs, the Llanowar Elves, and the Incubation Druids to help us do so. To fill in kind of the remaining slots here, we have Krall Harpooner, Merfolk Branchwalker, and Gruul Spellbreaker. Again, against Jeskai, the removal that they have, a lot of it's going to be instant speed aside from things like Lava Coil, so Gruul Spellbreaker felt like a really good card against what we could potentially be facing in Jeskai. Merfolk Branchwalker, kind of just another filler card. If it ends up becoming a 3-2 for 2 mana, that's, you know, fine. We can get pretty aggressive with it. If it ends up being more of just a 2-1 for 1 that draws us a land, that's fine because we need the lands to cast our giant threats anyway, so we're fine with just picking up an additional land. And then Krall Harpooner, this is the super secret fun tech that I've had for a while. Obviously, some people, like, it seems like a pretty simple interaction, but I haven't seen many people playing with it aside from myself. I've been having a ton of fun playing these matches in MTG Arena with Krall Harpooner and Rhythm of the Wild, because you see, Rhythm of the Wild gives your non-token creatures you control Riot. Krall Harpooner has this ability where on the first turn that it comes out, it can be gigantic. So if you end up giving this thing haste, you could be attacking with a 2-drop that attacks for 8 power, 9 power, something like ginormous out of just this simple Krall Harpooner. And aside from that, it can also just trade with things like a Niv-Mizzet, a Crackling Drake, or an Enigma Drake. It can eat up some smaller flyers like Afterlife Tokens or Healer's Hawk, something like that too. So Krall Harpooner, just a fantastic card and definitely needs to go in your Rhythm of the Wild deck. This card is so good with Rhythm of the Wild. Absolutely love it. And then as we look to the non-creature spells to round things out, we were Jund, so I wanted to throw in a couple of black cards as well. Find Finality, I think, is an okay inclusion here, even though we're playing Ferox, which makes us want to play as few non-creature spells as possible. I felt like Find Finality was still going to be a decent inclusion. We have the big creatures to survive the finality part of Find Finality, and at the same time, because we have all of these threats, if the game goes later on and we can use Find to bring back, say, a Nullhide Ferox and a Carnage Tyrant, and then use the next turn to cast Nullhide Ferox plus Carnage Tyrant, or just use next turn to cast double Nullhide Ferox even, that's just so good and can just end up winning us games that we were supposed to totally lose because of the ability to just recur those creatures from our graveyard back to our hand and then replay them out on the battlefield and force them to deal with those big giant creatures again and again. And then Assassin's Trophy, just kind of a catch-all. If they play, you know, some crazy planeswalkers, Vivian Reed, or we knew they were Jeskai, so we knew they weren't going to play Vivian Reed, but Rall is Viceroy, Teferi, Karn. The list goes on of just like these crazy things. Even if they play some of the enchantment removal, Seal Away, Ixalan's Binding, Conclave Tribunal, those sort of cards, Assassin's Trophy can deal with those. Deals with pesky creatures as well, so if they have like a Niv-Mizzet out and we don't have something to deal with the Niv-Mizzet right away, we can just go ahead and go for the Assassin's Trophy on the Niv-Mizzet, let them draw a card, take our one damage, but the Niv-Mizzet's gone and we can, you know, continue on with the game from there, having dealt with a huge dragon that would normally just end the game. So this was the deck I ended up putting together. I think it's pretty good. If you guys don't follow me on Twitter, I put together, I was testing this deck. I tested one match with it, and the very first match that I tested with it, I ended up with 2 lands in play and about 20 power worth of creatures on the board. It definitely made for a fantastic screenshot. So if you guys don't follow me on Twitter yet, go check out that tweet over on Twitter where you guys can see my board state and my first game testing with this. It was so cool. This is the deck that I put together. Should be a lot of fun. As we look at the mana base, 1 Swamp, 3 Mountains, and 9 Forests to go along with 4 Cinder Barrens, 3 Foul Orchard, and 4 Timber Gorge. Because of the deck building restriction, I felt like a lot of people were just going to jam a bunch of Guild Gates, jam a bunch of these Cinder Barrens, Foul Orchard kind of cards, and even jam like 4 Evolving Wilds in their deck. And so I wanted to kind of be the more proactive player. While they're maybe, you know, having mana troubles because all of their lands come into play tapped, I wanted to have the ability to play some of my stuff on curve or even above curve because we're playing the mana dorks. And so getting things like these 9 Forests out so that we're able to do things like cast Incubation Druids and use these mana dorks to help ramp us, even though we're stuck with multiple tap lands in our deck, having the ability to ramp and still play on curve is super important. So that's why we're running so many basic lands in this deck, despite it being a three-color deck. And then once we get the forest into play, we can really do quite a bit, especially because of like Incubation Druid. Even if we go like forest into, let's say forest, Incubation Druid, next turn we play Cinder Barrens. Already our Incubation Druid can tap for the black and the red mana then if we need it then on that turn, even though the Cinder Barrens entered the battlefield tapped. So I think this deck's pretty sweet. I can't wait to get in some games with it. It should be a lot of fun, and I'm looking forward to it. So again, you guys will get to see me play out the games. I'm going to record all of the games, walk you through my thought process as I'm playing these games, so you guys will get to see me take on some other content creators in the community, as well as get to hear me talk about the decisions I'm making as I'm playing out these games. So yeah, it should be a lot of fun. Hopefully you guys look forward to it. I'm gonna do the deck tech today here, and then we'll follow up throughout the rest of the week with some games of me playing against some of these other content creators, and it should be a lot of fun. So hopefully you guys look forward to it, and I'll be sure to keep you guys updated as more things happen with this Content Creators Community Cup. Once I get my games out of the way, there might be a little bit of downtime for a little bit, and then we'll start back up then with next month, where we'll have a brand new challenge, brand new teams, and I think it goes on for 3 months, maybe 4 months. I want to say it's 3 months, so it should just be some fun time, and you guys will get to see me play some Magic, which is always a fun time. So yeah, with that being said, hopefully you guys do enjoy this. Let me know what you guys would have built if you guys had this same deck building restriction. What would you guys have ended up putting together? I think Bronson ended up putting together some sort of a Aristocrats aggro deck, had things like Priest of the Forgotten Gods, Flameblade Artist, Gutterbones, and was just generating so much value. And then we had Langalia put together some sort of a Yargle mid-range deck that was pretty interesting choice. And then I think MTG ColorPie still hasn't decided quite yet what he's going to be playing for his deck, but I'm pretty happy with the deck that I ended up putting together. I think it turned out really well, and I'm really, really excited to go ahead and put together some games with it. It should be quite a bit of fun. So thank you guys so much for watching the video. Be sure to watch out for some gameplay videos coming up very soon playing this deck in the Content Creators Community Cup, and I will see you guys here next time. Thank you all so much for watching today's video, where I went over the deck that I'll be playing in the first month of the Content Creators Community Cup. Again, should be a lot of fun. At the end of all of my videos, I'd love to give a huge shout out and thank you to the people supporting me over on the Patreon page. So huge shout out and thank you to Nicole, also known as Battle of MTG, Hayden, also known as Down Under MTG, Jeremy, Jason, and Rodrigo for supporting me on the Patreon page. Definitely means a lot, everyone. I really, really appreciate it, and I'll see you guys here next time.